Thank you for joining us tonight for our midweek Bible study as we continue our series on mining the minor prophets. Tonight we're in the book of Zephaniah, chapter 3, so we encourage you to take your copy of the scriptures and turn with us, Zephaniah chapter 3. Now as we have seen in our last couple of weeks that we've looked into this book, our theme for this book is God's approaching judgment, and the day of the Lord, or the day, is mentioned over 20 times in this small little book of three chapters. And so Zephaniah is bringing this message of a judgment that's coming during his day, but it also looks future, that which is even future to us, the day of the Lord, the end times, which we call the second coming of the Lord. And so as we look at the time period of Zephaniah, who's mentioned down here, is preaching in between when Israel fell and when Judah fell to the Babylonians. He's contemporaries with Nahum and Habakkuk and the major prophet Jeremiah, and preaching a message to them as he lives there in Jerusalem. Now, we saw back in chapter 1 the judgment of the great day of the Lord, where the Lord begins with a general, universal judgment upon the whole world that's going to take place. Then he looks specifically at Judah and Jerusalem, and then he looks at the great day of the Lord that is yet future. In chapter 2, we looked at the judgment of the nations, and he goes to the four corners around Judah at that time, and looks at judgments that is going to come to the west of the country of the Philistines, to the east, Moab and Ammon, to the south, Ethiopia, and to the north, Assyria, just sort of giving all the corners of the compass a look at judgment that's going to come because of the way they have treated the people of God. Now in chapter 3, we see that this theme of judgment continues, but also, as is with God, his very nature, also restoration that is available to God's people. So let's dive in here in verses 1 through 8. We see here the judgment of Jerusalem. He comes back to that theme he had in chapter 1 to look once again at the judgment of his own people, of God's own people there at Jerusalem, and in the area of Judah. Notice, if you would, God's indictment against them. In verse 1, it says, "Woe to her who is rebellious and polluted, to the oppressing city." And here in this opening verse, he sort of gives a general statement of the indictment against them. They have been rebellious, they have been polluted, and they have been oppressors of God's people. And then he goes in and kind of expands on each of those in the following verses. In verse 2, he deals with them being rebellious against God. Notice what it says. "She has not obeyed his voice. She has not received correction. She has not trusted in the Lord. She has not drawn near to her God." The people that were supposed to be God's people, they're the people of Jerusalem. We see that they have become unteachable, that God has tried to correct them. God has sent prophets. He sent warnings to them. He even made a big example out of the northern kingdom of Israel, how that he warned them that if they did not turn back to God and do what was right and draw near to him, that they would be taken away into captivity. And sure enough, that's what God allowed to happen to the Assyrians in the fall of the northern kingdom. And so the same warning is being brought to this city of Jerusalem, but we see that they become unteachable. The writer of Proverbs says in Proverbs 5:23, "He shall die for lack of instruction, and in the greatness of his folly, he shall go astray." And that's exactly the direction that Jerusalem is headed at this time. So they've been rebellious against God. Notice next that they have oppressed their own people. Notice verse 3, if you would. It says, "Her princes in her midst are roaring lions. Her judges are evening wolves. They leave not a bone till morning. They're like the ravaging animals that are always looking for more prey. That's the way the leaders of Jerusalem were. They're always looking for another way to oppress the people and to exact more taxes from so that they could make themselves wealthy. 1 Peter 5:8 tells us about our enemy that we have. And again, that a ravaging animal is the picture. It says in 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And the devil comes as a roaring lion. He may come in different ways. He may come through different peoples. But we see that the devil is always trying to attack the people of God. And then we see in verse 4 an expansion of the thought of them being polluted. They were polluted religiously. And notice the leaders that were supposed to be leading them into righteousness are actually leading them in the exact opposite direction. It says in verse 4, her prophets are insolent, they are treacherous people. Her priests have polluted the sanctuary, and they have done violence to the law. We have seen in some of the other minor prophets, God scolding the priests and the prophets of that day that were leading the people away from worshiping God in the right and true manner. And that's exactly what has taken place here. Ezekiel, in his prophecy, said this in Ezekiel 22. He says, her priests have violated my law and profaned my holy things. They have not distinguished between the holy and the unholy, nor have they made known the difference between the unclean and the clean. They have hidden their eyes from my Sabbaths, so that I am profaned among them. And oh, what a terrible indictment against the leaders of that day, the priests and the prophets, that they have profaned God in the eyes of the people. But notice the contrast to the way the Lord has dealt with Jerusalem. Verse 5 says, the Lord is righteous in her midst. He will do no unrighteousness. Every morning he brings his justice to light. He never fails, but the unjust knows no shame. God never fails. God is always faithful. We can trust him in all ways. But yet we see that these religious leaders, they have been unjust. They know no shame. They go about their sin and they're not embarrassed about it. And so God's warning of judgment is very apropos for this time. Notice next, then God moves from his indictment to his judgment that he is going to bring. Verses 6 and 7 say this, I have cut off nations. Their fortresses are devastated. I have made their streets desolate, with none passing by. Their cities are destroyed. There is no one, no inhabitant. I said, surely you will fear me. You will receive instruction, so that her dwellings would not be cut off, despite everything for which I punished her. But they rose early and corrupted all their deeds. God says, look at the warning. Look at the example I put before you. I have devastated and made desolate and destroyed the nations all around you as a warning to Judah. But you have deliberately pursued the way of sin. You've not heeded the warnings that I put before you. The Apostle Paul describes the evil of our day in the same way in Romans chapter 1 and verse 32. It says, who, knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. And when we turn our eyes and our ways away from God, and we practice sin and continue in it, we're really begging for God's judgment to come upon us. And God is sure to judge. And we see God's universal judgment on all the nations who have sinned against them, against him, that God is going to Count everybody guilty of their sins and hold them accountable to that. Notice, if you would, verse 8, it says, "Therefore, wait for me, says the Lord, until the day I rise up for plunder. My determination is to gather the nations to my assembly of kingdoms, to pour on them my indignation, all my fierce anger. All the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy." So in Zephaniah's prophecy here, he's gone full circle. He started there in chapter 1 with a universal judgment upon all the nations. He then pronounces judgment upon Judah and Jerusalem, brings judgment upon all the nations, and now circles back to Jerusalem again, and then this universal judgment to all nations that have turned their back. And we see that this is ultimately going to be fulfilled when we get to the Battle of Armageddon that's mentioned in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 16, verse 14 and 16 says, "For they are spirits of demons performing signs, which go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty. And they gathered them together to the place called in Hebrew Armageddon." This is the yet future judgment that God has made. All the way back in the book of Zephaniah, we see that God has given that warning to us today as well. That those nations, those people that turn their back against God, one day God will gather them together for a great battle, the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Now, next, in verses 9 through 20, we see that God mentions the restoration of Israel. So that's God's ultimate purposes. God's mind, God's plan, His will is not that He wants to judge Israel. He wants to restore them. He wants to bring them back unto Himself. And so we see here the restoration of Israel that God has promised and that God is going to bring about. First of all, He mentions that in this restoration, there are going to be people from all nations who are going to come and serve the Lord. Notice verse 9, it says, "For then I will restore to the peoples a pure language, that they all may call on the name of the Lord to serve Him with one accord. For beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, my worshipers, the daughter of my dispersed ones, shall bring my offering." Now, when he mentions there that he will restore to the peoples a pure language, he's talking about purifying their speech. They that use their lips to profane God and curse God and blaspheme against Him, now God is going to purify their speech through the salvation that He brings. You know, one's lips represent what he says, which in turn reflects what's on the inside of a person, that inner life. Isaiah the prophet put it this way when he was standing before God Almighty in his vision, and he saw the Lord on His throne and the angels of God surrounding Him, crying out, "Holy, holy, holy." What was Isaiah's identification of himself? He said there, "So I said, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." The way he identified his inner sin and turmoil was that he was a man of unclean lips. What's on the inside is going to bubble out on the outside, as we see in the case of man. The nations who formerly had perverted by blasphemy and serving of idols now will be cleansed by God for true worship before Him. He mentioned there in verse 10, "my dispersed ones." And if you remember, Israel had been taken and spread out, dispersed throughout the Assyrian Empire when they came and took the northern kingdom. And they've been dispersed ever since. Through every different nation, you find pockets of Jewish people, and they have been dispersed throughout the lands. But one day, God is going to bring all of His people back. People will be saved, as we see here, from every nation during the tribulation period. And so God is going to bring a restoration there to the peoples of the world. It tells us this in Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 and 7. It says, "Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, 'Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water.'" And so that day is going to come. And thankful for God's grace and mercy, that even though God is going to bring great destruction on those that have rejected him, yet out of every nation, out of every tribe, out of every tongue, out of every people, there will be those that are drawn unto him, unto salvation. Next in our passage, we see the redemption of Israel. Notice, if you would, verses 11 through 13 in Zephaniah 3, it says, "In that day you shall not be shamed for any of your deeds in which you transgress against me. For then I will take away from your midst those who rejoice in their pride, and you shall no longer be haughty in my holy mountain. I will leave in your midst a meek and humble people, and they shall trust in the name of the Lord. The remnant of Israel shall do no unrighteousness and speak no lies, nor shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth, for they shall feed their flocks and lie down, and no one shall make them afraid." Verse 11, when it talks about that day, it's referring to the millennium, that 1,000 years after the time of the tribulation, when Jesus Christ comes and rules and reigns upon this earth. And those that populate the millennium are those that have survived the tribulation and turned to God during that time. There will be many Jews, but people from all nations will be drawn into that millennium. The Lord says that he's going to remove the haughty and the proud, and those that are left will be the meek and the humble, those that have humbled themselves unto the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Israel, who for so long had been defiled and turbulent and ravished, will at last be at rest among the nations, and they will be there without fear as Jesus leads them in the millennium. So notice verse 14 shows there the joy of Israel. It says, "Sing, O daughter of Zion, shout, O Israel, be glad and rejoice with all your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem." A day of rejoicing is coming to the people of God who have suffered the Holocaust of this world. I remember back when I was in South Carolina, and one of the joys I had was helping lead our seniors on their senior trip, and we'd always go to Washington, D.C. We had many fun-filled days, busy days, seeing all the different monuments and the Capitol and the White House and many different things. But in the midst of the week, we would start one day out going to the Holocaust Museum. And the seniors that we had with us, they didn't really know exactly what that was all about, and we'd be standing in line for a little bit waiting to get in, and they're joking around with each other and having fun as teenagers always do. But when they went into the Holocaust Museum, and there I think we spent about an hour and a half, and they went through all the different rooms that depicted what took place during the Holocaust and just the debauchery of humankind, the sin and devastation that humans brought upon other humans, where it showed what the Germans did to the Jews during World War II. When they would come out of that, they were all somber, in that you talk to them, they would say, "I can't believe that one human could do that to another human being." And it's important for us to remember the tragedies of the Holocaust. But one day, the people that suffered through that are going to be able to sing. They're going to be able to shout. They're going to be glad and rejoice because their king has come. Notice the King of Israel mentioned in verses 15 through 17. It says there, the Lord has taken away your judgments. He has cast out your enemy. The King of Israel, the Lord, speaking of Yahweh, is in your midst. You shall see disaster or holocaust no more. In that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear. Zion, let not your hands be weak. The Lord your God is in your midst. The Mighty One will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with His love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Now understand that it was the Jewish people, Israel, that rejected and crucified their king the first time that he came. But at his second coming, they will receive him. And it says that he will save, he will rejoice over you, he will quiet you with his love, he will rejoice over you, mentioned a second time. God, Jesus Christ, rejoices in his people. And he looks forward to that day when he will be able to rule them from his throne in Jerusalem, and they gather together to worship before his feet. Now, Zephaniah ends his book, verses 18 through 20, with looking at the future reward that will be Israel's during this millennial reign of Christ, when Jesus Christ comes and is their king. Notice what it says, I will gather those who sorrow over the appointed assembly, who are among you, to whom its reproach is a burden, those that... When they were in exile and when they were dispersed, they did not celebrate the Passover and the other appointed assemblies, as it says here, that God had ordained for the people of Israel to enjoy, to worship Him with. Verse 19 says, behold, at that time I will deal with all who afflict you. I will save the lame and gather those who are driven out. I will appoint them for praise and fame in every land where they were put to shame. At that time, I will bring you back. Even at that time, I gather you. For I will give you fame and praise among all the peoples of the earth when I return your captives before your eyes, says the Lord. Did you notice all the I wills in that passage? The I wills of God's restoration. He says, I will gather, I will deal, I will save, I will appoint, I will bring you back, I will give you. God is working on their behalf and makes them great promises of reward. Israel regathered becomes a source of blessing to the whole world, finally fulfilling the destiny that God had in store for them to bless all the nations of the world. When God was speaking to the remnant of Israel that had gone through the wilderness wanderings, the younger generation that had come out of Egypt or were born in the wilderness, after their parents, the evil generation had died off, and God was preparing Joshua to lead them into the promised land. He writes to them the book of Deuteronomy, the second giving of the law to this second generation. And in that, he made this proclamation to them in Deuteronomy 26, verses 18 and 19. He says, also today, the Lord has proclaimed you to be his special people, just as he promised you, that you should keep all his commandments, and that he will set you high above all nations which he has made, in praise, in name, and in honor, and that you may be a holy people to the Lord your God, just as he has spoken. That was the destiny that the Lord intended. And of course, Israel has chosen to stray from obeying the things of God, and God brought them warning, God brought them justice, judgment. But we see that in the end, at the end of the story, that God is going to set them high above all nations which he's made. He's going to give them praise. He's going to give them honor. He's going to give them a name because God keeps his promises. Now, you may ask, Well, what is the role of the church during the millennium? Well, as we understand from the scriptures, the next thing on the calendar for the church is to be raptured or to be resurrected if we passed on. And this takes place before the tribulation. And so the church is going to be taken out, and then the tribulation takes place where God meets out his wrath against a world that has rejected him. But even during that rejection, there will be 144,000 Jews that believe on Christ and take the gospel and preach it throughout the world at that time. And people from every tongue, tribe, nation, and people will be saved during that time. Jesus Christ comes in Armageddon to fight against all the armies of the world that have gathered against him. And it says that we, the church, will return with Jesus during that battle. Revelation 19:14 says, "And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, clean and white, followed him on white horses." And we will be with him in that battle of Armageddon as he takes victory over those that have rejected him. And then when we go into the millennium, the Bible says that we, the church, are going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ. Revelation 20, verse 6 says, "Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection." That's us. "Over such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. And so, even though Israel is the spotlight of the millennium, they are restored, and people from all over the world will come to Jerusalem to worship Jesus Christ on his throne. We see that he hasn't thrown the church aside. No, we are right there with him, ruling and reigning over the nations of the world during that 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ. So what a blessing it is for us to be a part of God's people today, the church. Yes, God made great promises, and those promises will be fulfilled to the people of Israel. But God's made great promises to us as well, and we're all going to be a part of that as we see the end days approaching. So keep your heart encouraged as you think about the promises of God. God is working in this world. He is using the church today to be a warning to all those nations that are sinning and rejecting him, that there is a judgment that's going to come. Praise be to God. We'll be taken out before that judgment comes during the tribulation period, and we will join the Lord Jesus Christ as he rules over that new Israel. We will rule and reign with him, and what a joy and a blessing that'll be to us. So may our hearts be encouraged as we see the Lord work today. Well, thank you for joining us. Let's close with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much for the word of God. And Lord, even in these small little books that we call the minor prophets, we see a hope and joy that is even ours as we see you fulfilling your promises of judgment, but yes, restoration to the people of God. Lord, I pray that our hearts would be encouraged as, Lord, many times it seems like this world is out of control, but Lord, we understand that you are in control, and Lord, all things will come together, and all things will be fulfilled according to your will, according to your plan. Lord, help us to keep our eyes focused upon you and not upon the circumstances of life. Lord, may we go forth victorious as we live for you today. Help us to be a faithful witness of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. Trust you have a good week.